good morning. Thank you. And I'm telling you, it is a privilege and an honor to be here this morning, to even be here and to be preaching even more so. If you don't know who I am, that's totally okay. My name is Heath Hatmaker. I'm the student pastor here at the Rolling Meadows campus, which is like the best job and the worst job that you could have. Our students are fantastic. I love serving them and leading them. I wanted to tell you a little bit about myself, a couple parts of my story. I didn't start as just a student pastor here at Rolling Meadows. My time with Harvest even started a bit earlier than that. Early in 2016, I was just a college student at Liberty University in Virginia. And I went into a class and I was told that Vertical Church Band was visiting, which I didn't know a ton about. But I met Andy Rozier and Vertical Church Band there in early 2016. And in March of 2016, I received an email that I had been accepted for a four-week internship at Harvest Bible Chapel. And so Pastor John asked if you remembered your first weekend that you were at Harvest. And this was my first weekend at Harvest. This was June the 4th, 2016. I'm the guy at the top middle, standing right behind like a 27-year-old Andy Rozier. And so I'm in the middle. I'll never forget standing on a riser. It was about right here. It's the first time I was at Harvest. I'll never forget standing here and singing, leading in worship. I'll never forget this moment, looking out, listening to you guys worship, watching you engage. I'll never forget just thinking, God, I would love to be a part of what you're doing here. And it seemed like this crazy vision or goal. And every time I come in the doors, even now, I'm just asking, God, I just want to be a part of what you're doing here. When I look out and I see you guys, that's all I want. It's just to be a part of what God's doing. And I believe he's doing some really great things. So I left the internship. I went back to college and I did one more year. And then in the summer of 2017, I was offered a job and accepted to be the student pastor here at the Rolling Meadows campus. And there was a girl that I interned with that I flirted with for probably most of the internship. And she just so happened to also get a job at Harvest in the same month that I did. And so after a year of me being politely rejected, I convinced her to go on one date with me. She agreed, and we have a picture now. This is 5 weeks ago. So, yeah. I really think that some of you like just came for the picture. You're like, I'm sure he's gonna show a picture of the wedding. I'm married to Colleen. I've been married for 5 weeks, and she is the most incredible woman. I love her so much, and marriage is fantastic. I've given this advice every service. If you are not married, do it. Being married is amazing. I love it. You see, the slogan for the summer is Everyday People, Uncommon Faith. And I wanted to tell you a little bit of my story to just say that that's me. I'm just a kid that was offered a four-week internship that asked God to do something. And he did. And that's my story, and for a lot of you, I'm sure it's yours too. And it's the story of the guys that we're looking at today. We're in the book of Mark, chapter 2. If you have your Bibles, I hope you do. Go ahead and take them out. We're in the Gospel of Mark, chapter 2. And the title of today's message is Relentless Faith. Relentless Faith. So before we jump into Mark, chapter 2, that means that Mark, chapter 1 has happened. So I want to give us a little backstory on that. In Mark, chapter 1, Jesus started his earthly ministry. He began by going into the wilderness and encountering John the Baptist. John the Baptist baptized Jesus. And from there, Jesus started his ministry. Almost immediately after being baptized, Jesus walks and he sees these fishermen. They're doing their job, they're fishing, and Jesus says, "Follow me, be my disciple." And they dropped everything that they had and followed Jesus. After they began to follow him, Jesus begins to perform miracles. He's in Capernaum, which is like his home base for the beginning of his ministry. So he's doing miracles in Capernaum. And he decides, okay, I'm going to branch out a little bit. I'm going to go into all the other regions of Galilee, perform miracles and teach. But before he left, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath, and he performed a miracle. He healed an unclean girl. That hadn't happened before. And so Jesus leaves after performing that miracle and travels to the regions of Galilee, and he returns. And that's where we're at here in Mark chapter 2. So let's look down at our Bibles. It says, when he returned to Capernaum after some days, it was reported that he was at home. And many were gathered together so that there was no more room, not even at the door. And he was preaching the word to them. And they came, bringing to him a paralytic carried by four men. The first thing that we see is that relentless faith takes action. Relentless faith takes action. I love that at this point, Jesus was just starting his ministry, but the name and the fame of Jesus had spread so wild that there was no more room in the house. He was teaching, people were gathered together. Jesus went viral. These people were coming to hear, who is this Jesus of Nazareth that I keep hearing about? Notice it says that there was not even room at the door. I wanted to bring out, I think this is the original overflow section. All these people are standing outside the door, they're listening to Jesus. But you see, the people that we're looking at today, they weren't even in that crowd yet. They don't come until verse 3, which I believe makes them the original I'm running late for church people. So, if you were following in their footsteps and you just rolled in a couple minutes late, we're glad that you're here. There's no stress, you made it. You're just like these guys. And they show up in verse 3. Let's look at our Bibles. It says that in verse 3, they came. Talk about everyday, ordinary people. What does it say their names are? It doesn't. It says they. So these men are carrying a paralyzed man to Jesus, and they don't have names. What all could they mean? Nisu, will you stand up for a second? Me and Nisu, we are considered they, right? Okay, go ahead, Nisu, take a seat. Hansons, can you guys stand up for a second? The Hansons, they're considered they, right? Okay, go ahead and take a seat. Now everyone, let's look around all together. Look at each other. We are considered they. You see, these men are just called they. Talk about ordinary people. Their names aren't even in the book. You know how many names there are in the Bible? It's a lot. Have you ever read Matthew 1? It's like a ton of names. There are 1,200 specific individual names written in the Bible. Yet these men are referred to as they. See, they didn't have a name in the scripture, but they had faith, and that faith spurred them to action. And so far, the action isn't too much. I mean, they showed up carrying a man, which is a lot. But so far, all they've done is just showed up. But maybe God would have you to hear this morning that you can't take action if you don't show up. You can't take action if you don't show up. And relentless faith takes action. If that's you, if you're like, man, if I'm honest, all I had left in the tank this morning was just a little bit left for me to show up. It's okay. It's okay. Because to have faith, you have to take action. To take action, you have to show up. Let's look at verse 4. our characters now. It says, when they could not get near him because of the crowd, they removed the roof above him. And when they had made an opening, they let him down on the bed on which the paralytic lay. Second thing is that relentless faith overcomes obstacles. Relentless faith overcomes obstacles. How cool is it that in the Bible, in one verse, they had to overcome all of these obstacles? There's so many. But why? Let's look at our Bibles. I remember, I'm a student guy here, so I'm used to being talked back to a little bit, so we're going to need to do better. Look down at our Bibles. What is the goal of the men? What is the goal? Why do they have to overcome the obstacles? The Bible says to get near to Jesus. Was the goal just to hear the message from Jesus? No. They could have done that from the street where all the people were gathered. Was the goal to be seen carrying a paralyzed man on a bed? No, because they went up on the roof where no one could see them. Do you think that these men just like, they walked by this house every Sunday, and so they just showed up because it's what they did? No. You see, these men had a goal, and their goal was proximity to Jesus. They believed and they had faith that all they needed was to be near to Jesus. It's because proximity to Jesus changes things. It does. Proximity to Jesus changes things. So I want to ask, why have you come today? Why are you here? Is this just a thing that you and your family do each week? I know Harvest Kids is great, free childcare. Is that why you're here though? Really, think about it. I had to think about this for myself. Why do I come every week? I hope that you can say, the reason you're here is the same reason those men were there on that day. Because you believe that proximity to Jesus changes things. I believe that being close to Jesus is worth overcoming any obstacle. For these guys, what does the Bible say? These obstacles that they had, it says the crowd was so big that they couldn't get near to Jesus, which is the goal. So what was their response? They climbed on the roof, carrying the man. Remember, they had to get him up there. They dug a hole in the roof, not big enough to just yell down, "Hey, Jesus, we got a guy up here that needs some attention. Can you come up top?" No. They dug a hole in the roof large enough to fit their friend on his bed and lower him down to see Jesus. By a show of hands, who here today to get to your seat had to climb onto the roof of the Rolling Meadows building, dig through the top, and lower yourself down to your seat? Anybody? See, that's student ministry. I knew somebody would raise their hand. No, nobody did. I'm going to say, I think if that were the case, some of us would have gone home instead. You see, I think that too often for us, when things get hard, we quit. When an obstacle is in our way, we quit. It could be something small. Every time I go back home, I'm from East Tennessee, I get asked one question. Is the winter really that bad in Chicago? Is it that bad? Oh, the 50 degrees below zero. Is that cold? It really snows 18 inches, really? Is it that bad? And I answer every time, no, it's worse. It is terrible. You see, if it snowed, if the winter was like that where I am from, the entire state would just stop. It would shut down. If there is the thought of the possibility of snow in the South, it deters people from getting to church, to school, everywhere. It doesn't take much in the South, but even here, sometimes the weather in the winter deters people from making it to church. It's an obstacle. You know the craziest thing? When the weather is that bad, people are deterred, they're a little nervous getting to church. If you go home and turn on your TV, the Bears might be playing. You know what you see when you turn on the Bears game? Soldier Field, full of people. You see, I think that sometimes our obstacles seem bigger or smaller based on how badly we want to get to our destination. People will sit in the snow if they really want to watch the game. And maybe weather is just this minimal thing. Maybe that's not an obstacle for you. Maybe it's something much more serious. Maybe waking up and feeling the regret from last night is a massive obstacle in you getting here and getting close to Jesus. Maybe the thought of the prodigal child that you've been praying for so long and not seeing the results that you want, maybe that's an obstacle in you getting here. Maybe a lost trust or a lost faith in people here. You see, nobody can avoid obstacles forever. But I think it's the response that we have that is a crucial piece. Our response to the obstacles. The men did what they had to. For us, when obstacles come, there are things that we should do. When obstacles come, we should dig in. Dig in. Rely on your faith, even more so. Give more time to intimacy with the Lord. When there's stuff in the way, don't retreat. Give more. Make your attendance to small group that much more important to you. When there's an obstacle, you need it that much more. Dig in. Get up earlier. Stay up later. Do whatever is necessary to have time with the Lord. Dig in. Secondly, hold hope. 1 Peter 5:10 says, "And after you have suffered a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish you." Hold on to that hope. Hold tight. Don't let go. And maybe even more than holding on to it, express it. Be a pillar of joy in the midst of a trial for your community. The next one I think is the hardest for me. Maybe it is for you. When obstacles come, reach out. Reach out. When there are obstacles in the way, search for accountability. Seems like when there's obstacles, it's easier to isolate, right? But when there are obstacles, search for accountability. Think about how much easier it would have been if one man was carrying his paralyzed friend to walk and get to a point and say, man, this walk is further than I thought it would be. Much more tired. And you'd lay down his friend and be like, I don't know, maybe we pray, maybe he walks this way after he's done teaching. But no, these four guys are walking together. They're looking at each other in the eyes. They have accountability. They're encouraging one another. They're spurring one another forward. Should be the same for us. Reach out. Or maybe the obstacle is a relationship with someone. Reach out. Commit to forgiveness and reconciliation in your relationships. When obstacles come, don't quit. Don't quit. Pray for endurance, to keep going. Pray for that person again. Invite your coworker again and again and again. Don't quit. Keep digging through the roof. When obstacles come, don't give Satan the pleasure of God's people throwing in the towel. Just don't quit. Lastly, trust God. Trust God. Psalm 84, 11 and 12 says, "For the Lord God is a sun and shield. The Lord bestows favor and honor. No good thing does he withhold from those who walk uprightly. O Lord of hosts, blessed is the one who trusts in you." Last thing we see is relentless faith experiences God's power. It experiences God's power. We see it pretty quickly here in verse 5. It says, "When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, 'Son, your sins are forgiven.'" Before we keep moving, what does the Bible say? Jesus saw their faith. Who is that? Is that just the men on the roof? Can their faith save the paralytic? Can your faith save your child? Can your faith save her? No. The Bible says that it's your faith that saves you. So the paralytic had faith. Jesus saw it, and he saves him. Now that's a first. So look back down at your Bible, verse 6. It says that some of the scribes were sitting there questioning in their hearts, "Why does this man speak like that? He is blaspheming. For who can forgive sins but God alone?" Verse 8, I love Jesus. "Immediately Jesus, perceiving in his spirit that they thus questioned within themselves, said to them, 'Why do you question these things in your hearts? Which is easier, to say to the paralytic, your sins are forgiven, or to say, rise, take up your bed and walk? But that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins,' he said to the paralytic, 'I say to you, rise, pick up your bed and go home.' And he, being the paralytic, rose. He immediately picked up his bed and went out before them all, so that they were all amazed and glorified God, saying, 'We never saw anything like this.'" Now, I don't know about you. Another little fact about me is that I grew up as a pastor's kid. And so I was in every Sunday school thing that was offered ever. So when I read the Bible, if I see the title of scribe or Pharisee or Sadducee, it's like this red light is flashing in my head. It's just like, bad guy, bad guy, bad guy, right? So we're like, oh no, the scribes, of course they questioned Jesus. Remember, Jesus had just walked into their synagogue on the Sabbath and performed a miracle and left, and he came back. Remember, that's where we're at. So these scribes are trying to figure out, who is this Jesus of Nazareth that's doing all these things? And they question this bold claim by this new rabbi. You see, the priests of the day, they could pronounce the forgiveness of sins. And so the sentence, "your sins are forgiven," wasn't something that they were mind blown about. But there was a condition. It only happened after visual repentance by physical sacrifice. That was when the priest could say, "Your sins are forgiven." Here in the Bible, Jesus looks at a paralyzed man who, according to scripture, hasn't said anything yet and says, "Son, your sins are forgiven." Which means that Jesus could only be implying one thing. Jesus is claiming to be God. Which is why the next words that he says to the scribes are so incredible. Verse 10, Jesus says, "But that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins. You see, this is the first time in the Gospel of Mark that the phrase Son of Man is used. It's used 14 times total in the book. And every time Jesus uses the phrase Son of Man to describe himself. Commentator William Hendrickson says that it's Christ's self-designation, revealing something with reference to him, but concealing even more, especially to those not thoroughly acquainted with the Old Testament. I love the imagery here. The idea that Jesus would call himself the Son of Man and would crack open the door and let them see a little bit while also concealing and keeping the door shut on everything else that Jesus is. 2 weeks ago, we had High Five here at this campus, which is our day camp for kids. I had the privilege of preaching at that as well, which is just like this, except there's not been as many interjections so far this morning. And it was a pleasure to preach to them. And if you've been around High Five, you may recognize this t-shirt. This is my tie-dye t-shirt that I wore for High Five. See, this means something to the kids at High Five. I would wear this t-shirt every day when I would preach. And when I was wearing the tie-dye t-shirt, I was Pastor Heath, the preacher. But I was another thing when I was wearing my tie-dye t-shirt. I was Pastor Heath, the water guy. And what that means, every day at lunch, all the kids go out to the parking lot and we have these water inflatables and little kiddie pools full of water. And I became the water guy, which means that I have two goals. One, get every kid wet. Two, don't get wet. That was the goal. That was the goal of the water guy. I would run around and chase and run away. And you see, when the kids saw me in my tie-dye shirt, I was Pastor Heath, the water guy. They would see me beforehand and they'd be like, I'm coming for you today. They knew who I was, right? But the craziest thing is, after High Five, even this weekend, I saw some of those kids in the lobby. And they walk by and they're like, I know that's Pastor Heath, the water guy, but he doesn't look like that right now. You see, during High Five, I cracked the door and I was the preacher and the water guy. But they didn't know that when the door is open, I'm Pastor Heath, the student pastor, and Pastor Heath, the junior guy's small group leader, or Pastor Heath, the husband to Colleen, Pastor Heath, the son to Carrie and Candy Hatmaker, who, by the way, my parents are watching on live stream, so shout out to my parents, hello. I just like doubled my Christmas money for this year, so let's give it up. Hey, Mom and Dad. You see, there's all of these things that I am that these kids did not know. I had cracked the door open to part of me, but they couldn't see the rest. The same way we see Jesus as he reveals himself, but he's also concealing so much more. We're going to get to see it. He reveals a little bit more of it, and he shows that he is exactly who he claimed to be in verses 11 and 12. Jesus says to the paralyzed man, I say to you, rise, pick up your bed, and go home. And he, the paralyzed man, rose, immediately picked up his bed, and went out before them all, so that they were all amazed, and they glorified God, saying, we never saw anything like this. You see, Jesus truly healed the paralyzed man a couple verses before when he forgives his sin. But the standing to walk is just a visual representation of the saving power of Jesus Christ. I think that too often when we pray and we ask for healing, we don't get what we expect, but God heals our souls, which is even greater. Maybe some of you are praying that God would provide for your financial success, when instead God is going to answer and provide contentment for you. Maybe some of you are praying that God would heal your marriage, but instead he's gonna answer and he's gonna heal your selfish heart. Maybe you would be praying that God would end a trial in your life, but instead he's gonna answer and he's gonna use the trial to grow your faith. You see, so often we want the thing, but God wants our hearts. We want the thing, but God wants our hearts. How differently would our trials look if we prayed that God would get glory, not that the situation would get better? See, relentless faith experiences God's power. I love it in verse 12. I love that he picks up the mat. Did you notice that? Jesus doesn't just say, rise, go home. He says, rise, pick up your bed, and go home. This mat, which once symbolized weakness and pain and suffering for this man, would now be a symbol of healing and of testimony. And isn't that just what God is like? That he would take the scars in your life and use them as a testimony of his grace? That God would take your love for money and your greed and turn it into a generous heart? That God would take a once divided family and unite them again for God's glory? That God would take the most broken thing in my life and in your life and turn it into the most beautiful thing? See, that's what God's power does. It does. And if you haven't seen that in your life, if you have faith in God and he is like that, it's on the way. Because relentless faith experiences God's power. Relentless is defined as oppressively constant and incessant. Oppressively constant and incessant. And I am praying that in the best way, our faith would be oppressively constant. Our faith, each of us individually, and our faith as a church, that it would be oppressively constant. Can you imagine how different life would have looked for this formerly paralyzed man if his friends weren't incessantly determined to get him to Jesus? I pray that our faith would be relentless. Would you pray with me now? God, increase our faith even now as we pray. God, would your presence drive us further into faith? Would you give us the strength and the endurance to overcome any obstacle that stands between us and a life-changing encounter with you? God, we believe that you can and will show up in power because it's who you are, Jesus. It's who you are, and we love who you are. I wanted to take a minute now, as we're still in the posture of prayer, to identify maybe an obstacle in your way. To identify those things, commit to relentless faith that overcomes those obstacles. Committing now to dig into your relationship with the Lord, to hold hope so tightly and refuse to let go. Maybe commit even now to reach out for accountability or for reconciliation. Commit now to not quit. Commit to trust God. Go ahead and take a minute now. Thank you. Jesus, we believe that you are what gives us power to overcome obstacles. We believe that proximity to you changes things. So God, just draw near to us as we're drawing near to you, we pray. In Jesus' name.